Big house, big car, backseat full bar. Houseboat won't float, the bank won't tote enough. Too much stuff. Woo! There's just too much stuff. It'll hang you up, dealing with too much stuff. Hanging out on the couch, putting on the pounds. Better walk, run, jump, swim, try to hold it down. Eating too much stuff. Too much stuff. It'll wear you down, carrying around too much stuff.
Hello, friends, and welcome to the December 2017 episode of All That Stuff, the last one of this year. Where does all the time go? I don't know. You know, my mother told me many, many years ago, she said, you know, Bill, the older you get, the faster time goes. And I'd always say, you know, that doesn't seem fair. And she'd say, well, it doesn't matter whether it's fair or not. That's just the way it is. So I'm old enough now to know that, once again, Mom's always right. And the older you get, it seems like the faster time does go. And here we are in December of 2017. And our show today, we're coming to you live from the studios of BCTV here on Friday the 15th at noon. And yes, that's not our normal time. Normally we do the third Wednesday at 9 p.m. But fortunately for you, the viewers of BCTV, you're going to get to see the Reading Royals live on Wednesday the 20th at 9 p.m. And you're getting to see me live on Friday the 15th at noon. Our show today is a recap of our third auction action on BCTV, which aired on Thursday, November the 30th. It was a great auction, had a lot of good results in it. If you watched our show last month, you know that was the preview show, and we kind of carry a theme, a sports theme, so we call that the preview show. And then, you know, an hour before the auction, we had what we call the pregame, and that's where we went over the rules and regs that govern auction action on BCTV, and where we talked about some of the items, where they were at, some of the bargains. And in the pregame show, we focused on some of the bargains that were still available. And then the show itself, auction action, we refer to that as game on. And now usually the All That Stuff show after, immediately preceding, immediately following the auction action on BCTV is usually a wrap up. And I like to do this for a couple reasons. I like you to be able to see some of the results. If you're watching auction action on BCTV, you know it goes fairly fast. And, you know, we have my friend and professional colleague, Brett Oslin, who was on my right, ear left on the TV screen on auction action. He was reporting the results. And my friend and professional colleague, Phil Wessel, was on my left, ear right. And he was telling you about items that were coming up that you wanted to keep an eye on, items that were closing. But it moves kind of fast, and you don't always get a chance to focus in on the results. So I like to take the All That Stuff show that comes immediately after an auction action on BCTV, and I like to do a review because it also allows us to focus in on the educational aspects of All That Stuff and auction action on BCTV. When I first started this show and talked with Heather Adams and Bill Martin about All That Stuff, actually I think, I believe I started the show before Heather came on, but I can't really remember. Maybe I didn't. when you get older, time moves faster and your memory moves a little slower sometimes. But anyway, I said I want it to be educational. It's got to be entertaining. These days you have to be entertaining. I hope we're entertaining. I hope you enjoy watching this. But I wanted to have an educational component because I think there's so much to learn about antiques and collectibles and fine art. And there's so many interesting ways that those items tie into our lives, not just as objects, not just as things to buy, not just as things to sell, but as representations of society, as historical stories. Political trends are involved, social trends are involved, human craftsmanship, art, all of those things are involved. And if you integrate them all together, they're actually quite interesting. And that's what we try to do on our show. I hope we accomplish that to some degree. And so this show today, we're going to go back through and we're going to look at some of the prices, realize some of the highlights, talk about those items in a little bit greater depth, and postulate on why it is that those items performed as well as they did. So this is Auction Action on BCTV Postgame, and I am Bill Howze, your producer and host, and I am an auctioneer and a personal property appraiser. Exactly. Let me go into it again because everybody tunes in at different times. I'm going to tell you a little bit about exactly what is Auction Action on BCTV. Well, if you haven't seen it before, if you haven't tuned in and you haven't heard about it, Auction Action on BCTV is a live, professionally produced auction with online bidding, online-only bidding, that closes live on BCTV on a set evening at a set time. And at that point, what we start with is we start with item number one, and every 45, 30 seconds to a minute, depending on the night and how many items we have, an item closes, and you're actually sitting in a virtual auction gallery that's as big as the entire world. People can bid internationally, they can bid nationally. You can be sitting right next door in your easy chair with your feet up, multitasking, and also participating in Auction Action on BCTV. It is also a public-private partnership between BCTV, the Renaissance Auction Group, and as I like to say, the community at large. Because BCTV supplies the technical prowess and they help us promote the show. My company, the Renaissance Auction Group, we produce the auction in a professional manner, all the way from taking in the consignments, taking the pictures, marketing the products, putting on the auction itself. You, the community, you're part of this project because you consign the items and you bid on them and purchase the items. Some people purchase them, some people bid on them and don't purchase them. That's okay. That's the way an auction works. So together, all of us working together, are creating a unique and interesting marketplace where we can market items that are consigned from people in Berks County, from people in Southeast Pennsylvania, sometimes from people in other parts of the country, and we can market them to the entire world. It's a public-private partnership between BCTV, the Renaissance Auction Group, and the community at large. Items are consigned at a set commission rate. And I'm going to explain to you a little bit how it works. You're not donating these items to BCTV. You're not donating them to the Renaissance Auction Group. You're consigning them just like you would to any professional auction company. The proceeds from the sale are returned to the consigner minus the agreed upon commission rate. And that commission rate varies depending on what's being sold, the desirability, the projected value, etc. It once again is a public-private partnership between BCTV, the Renaissance Auction Group, and the community. And BCTV receives a portion of the net profits generated by the auction. So that's what Auction Action is. We're still in the developmental stages. We still take it one show at a time. And we investigate how it's going. The feedback from the community has been overwhelmingly positive. People seem to enjoy participating in the auction. They seem to enjoy watching the auction. And they seem to find it to be a learning experience. And once again, that goes back to that word education. You know, there's lots of auction shows on TV now. And they're very, very interesting, most of them, if you like auctions. And I think they're very good for our profession. But a lot of them tilt toward entertainment because we're not dealing with Bill Howze and BCTV. We're dealing with HGTV and cable companies that are under pressure to turn a profit and producers on shows that are under pressure to turn a significant profit, to make their show be up there in the top shows that people want to watch on that channel or want to watch on cable TV. Well, in doing so, sometimes they have to kind of rearrange the facts a little bit so there's good TV. They can't really afford to just go out there and put on an auction and say, okay, that was a great result. That went for $1,080. Well, you know what? That wasn't such a great result. I think that item underperformed. You know, a lot of people don't find that interesting. You know, I think auctions are interesting. And I think being able to participate in auctions and watch auctions and see how auctions really work, how some things go for a lot more than you thought they would, and some things go for less than you thought they would. That's what I like about Auction Action on BCTV, and that's why I think it's also beneficial to our profession. Okay, let's see if we can flip back and forth a little bit. I'm just going to go in catalog order here and talk to you about some of the items that were highlight performers and tell you why I think they may have performed as well as they did, and hopefully help you determine whether you might have some items similar or maybe even the same items there at your house or in your collection. Lot number three was 53 World War II target charts. They ended up bringing $184 with the bid price and the buyer's premium. These were very unusual, and that was a good result for that particular item. The target charts were bought back from World War II by an individual who was a member of the 941st Engineer Aviation Topographic Battalion. They don't come up that often. You don't find them that often. But one of the consigners had a family that was very precise and meticulous about keeping things and documenting things. So when these came up, I was bought a lot of these items by this one consigner that said, "Do these have any value at all?" And I sorted through their items for them like I do for many consigners, and I said, "I think this has potential. That, not so much." And so then I went back with a van, and I picked up those items that we had sorted through, and it turned out that many of them did quite well. The target charts were unusual. You don't see them that often. They were primary source material for those who are interested in militaria and interested in World War II. And that's why they realized the result of $184.50 for the 53 target charts. Now, in that same lot of ephemera, and these two are paper ephemera, or come under the category of paper or photographic ephemera. One of the individuals in the family served in World War II, and he served in North Africa in 43 and 44, and then he moved to Italy. Also in that group were photos, a little over 300 photos that he had taken himself, almost all of them he had taken. I found a pack or two. They were all in little white envelopes. The envelopes had aged to yellow. Each one was labeled with where the pictures had been taken. When I took the photos out and looked on the back, I saw that either during his time of service or after he got back from the war, he had taken the vast majority of the photos, inserted them into the roller inserted them backwards into the roller of a typewriter and typed on the back where the photos were taken and what they were depicting. Those 300 photos bought $575 with the high bid and the buyer's premium. They probably would have bought half of that or less had they not been meticulously captioned on the back. The one you are seeing there is a candid. Now, I refer to these as candid photos because they were not posed, they were not staged, and they were not taken by a professional photographer. They were taken by an individual in the course of their daily life. This is a candid photo of Franklin Delano Roosevelt reviewing the troops in Salerno, Italy in 1945. Very interesting. Once again, primary source. There were pictures in there of POWs in Florence, German prisoners of war in Florence. There were pictures of natives, the native people of North Africa and Italy. There were pictures of war material. There were pictures of events during the war. And that, and the meticulous documentation, is why those photos, those 300 plus candid photos in black and white, bought $575. Lot number six was cruise line ephemera. Now, turns out, same consignor, same family, three generations of stuff, and they were fairly well-to-do. They lived on the main line down in Philadelphia. And they had money. They had money in the 1870s. They had money in the 1920s. They had money in the 1940s. They had money in the 1960s. And you're going to see a theme here. The cruise line ephemera, there were about, I think, maybe 17 to 20 pieces. You can go back, you can go online and still punch up past auctions on the Renaissance Auction Group website, and you can see the full description of every one of these lots and the price, the bid price realized. It does not reflect the buyer's premium. The prices I'm showing you today reflect the buyer's premium. Cruise line ephemera is a specialty. And there's always a lot of interest in it, particularly the menus. That's what people generally save. But usually you find them from the 30s and the 40s and the 50s and the 60s. The vast majority, almost all of these, were from late 1800s to 1912. It was a fantastic lot of cruise line ephemera, in my opinion. It bought $414. Now, one thing I want to talk about paper ephemera. I love paper ephemera. I love it because it's interesting. I love it because it's primary source material. I've used that word now three or four times. What do I mean? I mean firsthand. You're reading, just like newspapers are primary source. When you read a 150-year-old newspaper, you're reading the news of that day or that week, and you're reading it in the time that it happened, contemporaneous to the time that it happens. That's what primary source material means. There were menus and registries in that lot from the week that the Titanic was sailing the North Atlantic. Now, they weren't sailing on the Titanic. They were sailing on another line, fortunately for them. But there were pieces of cruise liner memorabilia from the week of April 12th, 1912. That's kind of neat. And that's what I mean when I say that when you touch some of this stuff, when you look at it, when you examine it, you're touching history. You're touching history. Lot number 6A was World War II ephemera plus another interesting item or two. Once again, bought back by the same individual. Those three maps you see on the top right, they are 1944 Michelin maps of North Africa in pristine condition. This individual didn't throw much away. Now, what you're seeing on the top left is one of the plus items. That is a membership certificate in the Grand Army of the Republic post in Phoenixville from, I think it was 1901. Of course, the Grand Army of the Republic was the name of the Eastern forces of the Union in the Civil War, the Grand Army of the Republic. And I'm sorry, yes, Grand Army of the Republic. So this was a Civil War piece. So this came from the generation or two generations before. But it wasn't made or enacted during the Civil War. The Grand Army of the Republic, not surprisingly, continued to have reunions for many, many years because the Civil War was such an iconic aspect of American history, a turning point in American history. Also included in this lot that wasn't World War II memorabilia was a sign from the 1931 Paris Exposition, World Exposition. That lot, all told, about $242.50. I toiled mightily putting that lot together, figuring out what should go in, what should stay out, etc. I think that was a good result. Did it go out the top? No, but I think that was a very good result. And in some other location, in some other form, it might have been sold as a box lot for $30. There's three things it takes to really make an auction. Okay, there's three categories everything falls under. There's thousands of steps and a lot of different things have to come together. But one, you have to have product knowledge. You have to know what you're selling. Number two, you have to be able to market what you're selling to the people that want it. And number three, you have to be able to produce an auction where it's user-friendly, where people feel appreciated, where people feel like they can get honest, transparent transactions. So a lot of it comes under product knowledge and recognizing what has value. Lot number 8, early railroad ephemera. Well, we're seeing a little trend here, aren't we? Yes, another lot of ephemera. Yes, coming from the same consigner. At least one member in one generation of the family loved railroads. There was railroad this, railroad that. There were just lots and lots of stuff about railroads. What's interesting here is the top three items you see on your left are railroad menus from the 1880s. You don't see many railroad menus from the 1880s. When you see railroad menus, they're from 1920, 1930, 1940, 1950, just like the cruise line memorabilia. But this member of the family, and that generation was taking their grand trip all the way from Philadelphia to San Francisco and through the West. And they saved these three railroad menus from 1884. I'm calling that from memory, but I believe they were from 1884. You don't see that very often. There were a few other railroad things in there. You can see there's a Reading Railroad timetable from the 1930s, I believe it was. There was a little railroad-themed Valentine that was kind of cute. There were a couple of railroad-related books and pamphlets relating to railroads in Philadelphia around the 1900s. But what was driving that lot were those three railroad menus on the top left. The lot with the high bid and the buyer's premium bought $172.50, and that was a good result. Lot number 12 was 14 vintage PA license plates. There were three 1926 license plates, and then it went to the 40s, and I believe there was a solid run from 47 to 57 or 47 to 58. They were in decent condition, good condition, actually probably pretty good condition as license plates go. They weren't pristine. They had been used. They had all come off of cars. None of them had been bought and then taken off the car and just sat around on a shelf somewhere. So they were nice. And they bought $115, and that was a good result. The most expensive license plate that I have sold here in Pennsylvania was a 1913, I believe it was, enamel plate with the number 4, because the individual was the road commissioner at that time. And license plates had, at that time also, they had a license plate on the front and a license plate on the back. And I had two number 4 Pennsylvania license plates. The governor got number 1, the governor's wife got number 2, I believe it was probably the lieutenant governor got number 3, and the road commissioner got number 4. And it came out of a family whose ancestor had been the road commissioner in 1913. Lot 12A, a Steppenwolf poster from 1970. Now I'm going to tell you a little story. I related it briefly during the auction itself. Once again, as I said, I visited these consigners first. They showed me what they had. They said, "Can you help us? Or can you help tell us what might have value and what doesn't have value? And can you tell us what you might want to sell?" And I said, "Surely I can do that." So I went over one time and we sorted through all the stuff, and then I came back later to pick it up. But as we were sorting through it, they said, "Well, what about this poster? It wasn't really in the best shape." But I said, "Yeah. I mean, as condition goes, I would have marked it a good, maybe a good minus on poor to excellent scale." I said, "Yeah, we will give that poster a try." And then I saw the wife look at the husband, and then I saw the husband look back at the wife with rather meaningful glances, and I'm thinking, I wonder what that's all about. And they said, "Well, you know, we threw all the rest of them away last week." Oh, no. Well, easy come, easy go, right? Probably when they were collecting those posters, which was probably when they were about the age that you would go see Steppenwolf in 1970, they were probably pulling them down off of telephone poles somewhere. The lesson here, and the reason I go over this, is not to make anyone feel bad or not to cry over spilled milk. It's to say, folks, don't throw stuff away. If it's an estate, if it's coming to you, maybe from somebody, you remember the Dutch never throw anything away, somebody that saved everything, and you're thinking, "Oh my God, this house is a wreck, and you know, we got to get it ready to sell, and you know, we got to get it ready to close on the real estate, whatever it might be, we got to get rid of this stuff." Before you get rid of it, don't clean everything up and then call me first. I'm very good. Or call any professional you would like to call, whether they're an auctioneer, a dealer, whatever you want to do, and whoever you want to deal with. But call us first, so that I'm very adept. I can go through the biggest mess you've ever seen, and I can poke through it in 30 minutes to an hour, and I can help you sort real quick. I can tell you what's valuable or what's potentially valuable and what really has little to no value at all. And almost every time when the pile's done and the individual looks at the pile, they say, "Wow, I probably would have thrown that away. But I thought this over here in the pile of the not valuable, I was always told by my grandmother that this was really, really valuable. Well, it may have been. Just like mom's always right, grandmom's always right too. But the thing is, that was 60 years ago it was valuable. And it may not have the same value. It may not have accrued and accelerated in value. It may have decelerated in value. And it may have little to no value at all anymore. This goes back to the changing trends. This is one thing I find very, very interesting about antiques and collectibles, about my business as a professional auctioneer and as a professional appraiser. Just like, we used to all love our transistor radios. Well, now if you love a transistor radio, it's because you're a collector. It's not because that's how you listen to the radio anymore. Well, antique and collectible trends are the same way. When I helped my parents dispose of their cut glass collection in the 1980s, they had about 1,100 pieces of American cut glass, most of it American Brilliant Period cut glass, some of the finest glass ever made in the United States. If they had that collection today, still had it, it would probably be worth about 25% of what we garnered from selling the collection in 1980. Now, that's not just because a transistor radio was cheap in the 1950s, and it's actually more expensive today than it was in the 1950s, but we don't use that radio anymore. Cut glass was one of the finest art items ever produced in the United States, but people's tastes have changed. And so if we still had those 1,100 pieces of cut glass today, we would probably be realizing about 25% of the value that we realized when we sold them in 1980. So trends change. And I think that's one of the very interesting things about antiques and collectibles, one of the many interesting things about antiques and collectibles. Let's move along. Lot 13A were lead Christmas figures, polychrome lead Christmas figures. They're sometimes referred to as flats. Others sometimes referred to as German flats. I had two sets. One of them was from the 30s, and one of them was probably from the 50s. But one set was still in its original box. You'll notice that on your top left. See, they're leaning up. That's the box that they came in. Okay? I was wondering if... Better? Yeah. Thank you, John. All right. Now you can hear me. Oh, boy. They were saying we kind of liked it better when his mic was down lower on his tie. All right. Lot 13A was a group of what are referred to sometimes as German flats or Nuremberg flats. They were polychrome. They're Christmas decorations. They project various scenes. One of them was a skating scene, and one of them was Santa's workshop. Having that original box, you hear a lot about boxes sometimes. You hear a lot about boxes with toys, and other original containers. That lot realized $241.50 with the high bid and the buyer's premium, and that was a good result. Lot number 14, paper mache jack-o'-lantern. This was a fairly early paper mache jack-o'-lantern. It realized $218.50 with the bid and the buyer's premium. Why? Why was it the most expensive of the nice set of jack-o'-lanterns we had? It was earlier. It was a generation earlier. It also had that nice little label on the bottom from the Schwartz, not FAO Schwartz of New York, but from the Schwartz Toy Store of Philadelphia. Halloween is hot. Halloween decorations are hot. You're going to see a couple more examples. There's a couple generations of Halloween decorations. You can sometimes find them from the late 1800s, and many of those are going to be some of your most valuable. You can find them from the first 2 to 3 decades of the 20th century, and those are going to be the most valuable of the ones that you're most likely to find. And then you're going to find the Halloween decorations post-World War II, let's say, or the 40s on. And those have value as well, but if you're watching Auction Action, you saw a noticeable drop between the pre-war and the post-war. Let's use the war as the breaking point. It's not exactly the way with Halloween decorations as it is with trains, but model trains, but let's use the war as the breaking point. You saw a drop in value between the pre-war and earlier, when we're talking about World War II now, and post-war. This once again, this was bought by a collector in Kansas, and it realized a price of $218.50 for a paper mache jack-o'-lantern, a Halloween paper mache jack-o'-lantern. Good result. Well, this was the grand winner of the prize. It was lot number 15. It was a stereoscope, and there were 46 stereo views. I knew there were other stereo views that were consigned by the same consigner, but I knew as soon as I saw this lot and this group, I sorted them out myself. I sorted 46 out of the 350 or so, and I put the stereo viewer with them. These were all scenes from the United States, and they were from several places in the United States. What drove them to a high bid and buyer's premium price of $1,081 was a combination of things. The scenes. The most valuable in there was probably the scene of the Atlanta train station. There were four scenes from Cripple Creek, Colorado, and a well-known photographer. The photographer and the scenes are what drive the value in stereo views. There were some interesting, what would have been interesting to all Pennsylvania collectors and railroad collectors, is there was probably 10 to 12 scenes from the Lehigh Valley Railroad and one of the other local Poconos coal country railroads. There were scenes from Detroit. There were scenes from New Orleans. There were probably 15 scenes from New Orleans. It was the fact that they were American, and remember, these are 19th century scenes, is the fact that they were American scenes. It was the scenes that they were. There was one scene was a very famous bridge in St. Louis being built in the 1870s or 80s, and it was the photographers that took them. But that was the winning lot as far as the highest sale lot for this particular episode of Auction Action on BCTV, and it bought $1,081. Lot number 18, we're back to photos again. 700 plus candid photos from the 1910s through the 1930s. They were in seven albums. Six of the albums looked like the ones on the top left, the green albums, the green cardboard faced albums. They were all scenes from Philadelphia, the Poconos, Maine, and New Jersey in the 1910s and 20s. Some of them even going back probably to the late 1800s. They were all candids. Once again, these were not taken by professional photographers. They weren't posed in a studio. They were all candid shots, and they showed everything you can imagine. They showed dogs and boats and cars and early airplanes and what the main street of this town or that town or the other town looked like in 1910 or 1914 or 1922. But best of all, they were all labeled, every one of them. Just like the photos that I showed you in the World War II lot, every one of them, now in this case it was the pages that were labeled, not every photo like in the other lot, but the pages were labeled. The photos were still in their albums, and there's one other thing that drove this lot. And once again, this is why we're going through these things again. It's not just to tell you, look how much this bought. That's interesting. Everybody likes to talk about money and talk about how much things are worth, you know. But the vast majority, 98% of these photos were not mounted into the album. Mounted meaning glued or adhesed in some way into the album. They were held by the corner holders so that every one of those photos could easily be slipped out of the album without damaging it. It was the fact that they weren't front mounted, that they were put in with the corner pockets, and the fact that they were labeled that drove this lot of 700 plus candid photos to $529 with the high bid and the buyer's premium. Now the suede album you see on the right, that was one generation later. That was from one individual's grand trip around the country and the West in the 1930s. And included in that album were pictures from the 1930s of Grand Canyon, Bryce, Yellowstone, Glacier, Once again, primary source material. If you wanted to know, I jokingly said to my wife, because we love to travel, and we love to travel the West, and we love to go to national parks and to areas of scenic wonder in this fantastically beautiful country that we've been granted stewardship over. And there was a picture of looking out from a famous spot at Bryce Canyon, probably one that most people stop at, and looking across the canyon at the rock wall. And it was 1930, and I said to her jokingly, you know, it hadn't changed much. that rock wall still looks about exactly like it did. Now, I will say, if you went out there today and took a picture and you held them closely together, you would probably see the effects of erosion and rock falls. But just glancing at it, it looked exactly like it looked the last time we were there 4 years ago. What drove these photos? What drove these photos is they weren't front mounted and they were identified. All right, lot 21, German miniature toys. This is a great little lot. These are around turn of the century. All hand-carved, all handmade, hand-painted, little cows and little horses and carts. And you can see there were some village scenes. One of them may have been used in association with model railroads. Some of them, if they were, they were a smaller model railroad because they weren't really that size. But these were just, for the most part, toys. Nice wooden German toys. They realized $126.50, which was a good result. But, you know, that didn't go out the top. You know, there was probably more room in that lot. But it was very interesting. It was nicely done. It showed wonderful craftsmanship. And my consignor was pleased, and I was pleased with the result. We had some coins, and the coins did well for the most part. Lot 23A was 9 cents. There was the 1908 through 1915 S mint. And then there was a 1922 D, which is a semi-key date in the Lincoln cent series. The nine together bought $126.50. Coins. I had Chris Pilliot on maybe 4 or 5, 6 months ago. Chris is a known numismatist, well-respected numismatist who lives here in Berks County, but is known throughout the country and even throughout the world, and well-respected as a numismatist. And we told you some things about coins, like everything else. It's condition, it's the date, and it's the mint. Condition, date, mint, and then also the material that it's made of. Obviously, gold and silver coins, all things being equal, bring more than copper coins. A very rare copper coin will bring more than a very common silver coin. A key date copper coin, or a key mintage copper coin, or a rare copper coin in superb condition will bring more sometimes even than a gold coin. Lot 29, we're back to Halloween decorations. Now this is a little bit later than the pumpkin, but not a lot. This is still, these are called die cuts. They're German. Germany made the best die cuts. They're heavy cardboard. They're embossed and they're raised. And they're called die cuts because they were cut by dies out of larger sheets. This little devil stood about 16 inches high or so. It was in nice shape for its age, generally speaking, since Halloween decorations were used, unless you find new old stock from a store that was never sold or somebody bought it and put it in the drawer. Halloween decorations were used for its age and for its size and for the fact that it had all those little tendrils, you know, all those little pieces, his ears, the end of his trident sword, the leaves that are at his feet, which would be to the right on your screen there. All of those are just little thin pieces of paper sticking out in the air. And after they've been used for 70 or 80 years or so, the ends tend to bend or break off. A lot of times you have a lot of paint loss if they were stored in places of high humidity, or they become very brittle if they were stored in places like an attic where it was high heat in the summertime and very cold in the wintertime. This one overall was in good condition, and this little devil recognized $149.50 for the bid and the buyer's premium, and that was a good price. Okay, these were 9.5 millimeter vintage motion picture films. Excuse me. This particular variety is known as Pathex. That is a trade name. Others were known as pâté, P-A-T-H-E, with the E having the French slash coming from right to left, coming from the top to the bottom. That's known as an accent aigu. And when you see the E with an accent aigu, you pronounce the E as a long A, pâté. But these were pâtés. The difference between pâtés and pâté was about not quite a half inch in the diameter of the reel. There were, I think, about 44 of these. Lots of interesting and famous names were in them. Douglas Fairbanks was in there. Our gang was in there. Felix the Cat was in there. An interesting thing I found in cataloging these is, not surprisingly, there's a service now where you can have these fragile films, relatively fragile, once again, coming from the same consigners, very meticulous people. These were kept in a black wooden case that was fitted just for these films, and these were in, I would say, relatively good shape, probably a little bit better than relatively, and many of them still had their original boxes. But you can have these films taken now and have them put on DVD, so that you'll still have the original film. You certainly don't want to get rid of that, but they can be in a more stable medium for the next 100 years. And also you can enjoy them without running them over and over and over again, which would probably enhance their rate of deterioration. The 44 motion picture films, you know, film releases, about $310.50. And we're going to revisit their cousins here in just a few lots, and I'll show you what I mean by that. But that was a good result, $310.50, and it was a good buy for the buyer. Those went to New York. Back to Halloween decorations. Here was the number one Halloween decoration. German die cut again. It's a black cat in kind of a faux frame, heavy cardboard, same era as the devil. It bought $379.50, and I can tell you, without revealing any secrets, that there was a significantly higher bid left on it. But the underbidder only drove that piece to $379.50, and I say only, that was a very, very good result. But there was a collector in another part of the country that wanted that piece, what you're looking at there was probably, I don't know, maybe 10 by 14. You know, once again, you can go to our website, you can go to past auctions, and you look up and get the full description of every one of these. We leave it up there because that's a resource for you. You can go to our website and say, you know what, I saw a Halloween decoration, and I think I saw the same one on that show that guy does, you know? And then go to our website, and you'll get a full description of it. You'll get a full description of size, and you'll get a professional catalog description for the most part on every item. Lot number 32, Halloween decoration, $379.50. I was talking about the cousins. Along with the 44 copyrighted films, professionally produced films that were released to be seen in the movie studios, there were and I can't remember the exact number, probably about 35 plus candid films, just like the candid photos, except these were motion picture films. Now I ask you, who was taking candid motion picture films in the 1920s, 10s, 1930s? People who had that interest and people with money who could buy the film and could buy the camera and had the time to go interesting places. What was included? What was included in some of those films? There was a track meet, a Haverford track meet from the 1920s. There was a Haverford football game from the 1920s. There was one reel of someone traveling the Going to the Sun Road in Glacier National Park in the 1910s. Now, Glacier National Park is one park that has changed tremendously since 1910. The vast majority of the glaciers are gone. But I guarantee you the Going to the Sun Road, if you've ever been on it, it's not always spectacular, but I guarantee you the road itself has changed quite a bit since 1910 to 1920. And right in there was a 9.5 millimeter candid home movie of someone on the Going to the Sun Road in Glacier National Parks. There were other national parks included. There were places the family visited, Eaglesmere, Pennsylvania, Maine. There were pictures of home places. It's just a great, great lot. Same person bought those that bought the Pathex for just slightly less, about $40 less. They recognized the bid and the buyer's premium. $276 was the final number. Same family. Except this goes back one more generation. Magic lantern slides. End of the 19th century. I had about 11 boxes of magic lantern slides. Most of them were Italy, Switzerland, Germany, Spain, England. And as I'm going through the boxes, I come across this one box. I think it was 40, no, it's 95. 95 slides, but I start taking them out. Oh my God. There's the Alamo, magic lantern slide of the Alamo in the late 1800s. There's Glacier National Park. There's Yosemite National Park. Can you see the trend? It's interesting to watch the family trend. This is how you get to know people sometimes when you've never met them. You know, now we're back in the late 1800s. Same trip being taken, you know, Glacier National Park. Yellowstone, Grand Canyon, magic lantern slides. Now those pictures were taken in black and white and they were hand tinted. Didn't have color photography and color film in the late 1800s. And I took those 46, or 95, I'm sorry, and I sorted them out and I said, these are gonna be the winners among the magic lantern slides. And they were. The rest of the boxes, most of the boxes averaged between 75 and 100 magic lantern slides. Most of those boxes bought $100 plus the buyer's premium, okay? So they bought a little over $100. This lot bought $299, and it's a wonderful, wonderful lot. It is firsthand Americana from the late 19th century. Lot 36A, we had two of these. They were five-stack Globe Warnke bookcases. The two five-stacks recognized exactly the same price, $402.50. These are always popular. Say 20 years ago, they probably would have bought at least 50% more, maybe 60% more. If you go to a retail store where people can leave them sitting there for 5 years, you may see them priced at 50 to 60% more, but that was a good result. $402.50, there were two of them. Those were step backs. That means the bottom shelf was wider than the other four. The nice thing about Globe Warnke's is they're made to kind of mix and match. You know, generally speaking, they're all the same. Well, we're down to 10 minutes already. All right. They're made, you can take the same ones and you can mix and match them all together. Well, the time's flying while we're having fun. 36 real photo postcards. I sorted these 36 postcards out of over 2,500 to 3,000 postcards. I spent an entire day doing nothing but sorting those 3,500 postcards. I sorted these 36 out. They're about $241.50. Why? Because they were real photos and they were the American West. Four-stack bookcase, about $276. I'm going to pick this up just a little bit. $276 for the four-stack bookcases. This was about 140 postcards that were purchased by our serviceman serving in North Africa in 1943, 1944. Every one of them was postally unused. They were somewhat unique. Some of them was the history of French military uniforms because the French had a big presence in Algeria and in North Africa. Some of them were what are called caricatures of the local populace. A fair number of them were artist signed. You see those signatures there on the two on the lower left. You can't read the signatures, but you can see how they're signed. Artist signed postcards can add value. About $161 with the bid and the buyer's premium. This was an interesting bronze patina. It was not bronze, but one of the nicest match holders I've seen in a long, long time, and a trick match safe. And as the joke went around in the gallery there, as people were coming to preview, if you were in the Alps, and it was cold and you needed to start a fire, you wanted to make sure you had not stored your matches in this trick match match case because it might take you a day or two to get it open. It was Swiss, it was carved, it was 1880s. Nice, the two of them together, $126.50. Magic Lantern Slides of Switzerland. Why did I put these in? These were the second highest performing Magic Lantern Slide lot. They bought $138 with the high bid and the buyer's premium, significantly less than the $95 from the U.S. West. But these were part of a travel lecture that the gentleman gave, and all of his travel, handwritten travel lecture notes were right there. And we combined them with this lot of Magic Lantern Slides, and it propelled this lot to about 40% more on average than the other Magic Lantern Slide lots bought other than the U.S. West Magic Lantern lot. This lot 58 was a 7 over 8 tail feathers, MS-62 Morgan dollar at about $138. What the rest of the postcards bring, all that other 2,000 or so, many of which, some of them were as early as 1890s, there were some nice postcards in them. All of that lot, after I had sorted out five other lots, including the one that I showed you of the Real West photos that bought almost $300, bought $276. Don't throw your postcards away. Not all postcards are valuable. Condition means everything, subject matter, and age. The high performer for the coins was the lot 62A, the 1848 trade silver dollar, $241.50. That was a good result. Trade dollars are iconic, though. They were only produced for a relatively short period of time, and they're always sought after. This was not an exceptionally high grade, so $241.50 was a good result. 1913 Pennsylvania Railroad Mainline Atlas. Talk about primary source material. This had 27 plates of the main line, the PR&R main line route from Overbrook to Paoli, and every plate had all of the adjacent property owners named. So if you wanted to know who owned what property and what the property looked like and what it looked like on the PR&R line from Overbrook to Paoli in 1913, and this was a large atlas, this was priceless. The guy came up and bought it. I believe he lived down in Hatfield maybe or someplace. He was ecstatic to get it. $299. Nice result. Lot number 71 was the Lebanon Coin Club. Another interesting thing. These came in a coin holder, coin book. I looked at them. Obviously, the majority of them were bronze medallion. I thought the others, they must have a silver patina. But I said, no, I'm going to check these out. So I took the first silver ones out of the coin book and found written on the side, 0.999 fine silver. That means they were pure silver, and there were 36 of those, and there were about 40 or 50 of the bronze and the bronze patina. Altogether, they bought $356.50. You want to deal with auctioneers who do their due diligence and who take their time and carefully look through the items that they're consigned. There's lots of them, lots of good auctioneers around, but not all auctioneers are created equal. So when you're dealing, you want to be dealing with auctioneers with good product knowledge and who have the time to do and take the time to do their due diligence. Number 73 was an aneroid barometer altimeter from the late 19th century. It realized $126.50 in its as-found, as-is condition. Interesting item, scientific instrument, good result. Lot number 74 was a World War I trench art, three pieces of World War I trench art. Trench art was produced by people soldiers working, they took things, generally armaments and shells, and they made art out of them. You know, they embossed them. Most of them are etched. They would sit there and tap on them with little sharp awls and things like that to make artistic designs. This was a nice lot of three. It bought $92. Auction action on BCTV. What is it? Items are consigned at a set commission rate. Proceeds from the sale are returned to the consigner minus the commission. It's a public-private partnership between BCTV, the Renaissance Auction Group, and the community at large. And BCTV receives a portion of the net profits generated by the auction. Auction action on BCTV. We're now accepting consignments for the next episode of Antiques, High Collectibles, Fine Art, The earlier you can sign, the more time we have to research, catalog, and promote your items. You can contact me by email, bill@auctionhouse.com. You can call me on the phone. I'm available from 9 to 9, Monday through Saturday, and 1 to 9 on Sunday. If I can't take your call, leave me a message, and I'll get back with you at my earliest opportunity. And if you don't remember the number, if you don't remember the email address, if you don't remember the Renaissance Auction Group, call BCTV and say, how do I get hold of the auction guy? What type of items, quality items, and all categories of antiques, collectibles, and fine art will be considered, including but not limited to coins, jewelry, sterling silver, fine porcelain and glassware, original art, vintage prints, paper ephemera, antique and fine furniture, and also particularly we have a subcategory for items of local interest, Reading, Berks County, Southeast Pennsylvania, and surrounding areas. Once again, that contact information, you can visit our website, www.auctionhouse.com, and submit your email from there. You can email me directly, bill@auctionhouse.com, or you can call me at 610-370-2879. And our next episode of All That Stuff is Wednesday, January 17th at 9 p.m. Okay, folks, I've got just a few minutes to go, and I want to offer you a personal message. This is a time of year when many, many cultures and many, many nations take time to celebrate for a variety of reasons. So I hear people say, oh, I'm so glad we can say Merry Christmas again. Well, I never stopped saying Merry Christmas. I never stopped saying Happy Holidays. I never stopped saying Happy Hanukkah. I never stopped saying Have a Super Solstice. I love the winter solstice. I love everything, the history and the culture of the winter solstice, which predates Christianity, Judaism, and the Muslim religion. So my mother also told me, she said, Bill, it's not what you say, it's how you say it. So whether you say Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, Happy Hanukkah, Super Solstice, Joyous Kwanzaa, it's not the words, it's the meaning. So I'd like to urge all of us at this time of year, with joy in our hearts, to wish for peace on earth and goodwill towards all. I want to thank you for supporting All That Stuff. I want to thank you personally for supporting me and the Renaissance Auction Group. And most of all, I'd like to thank you for supporting Berks Community Television, Berks County's voice to the world. Have a wonderful Christmas. Happy Holidays. Happy Hanukkah. Super Solstice. Joyous Kwanzaa. We'll see you next year.
Yeah, it'll tear you down. Fooling with all that stuff.
That's a lot of stuff. That's a whole lot of stuff.
There's just too much of it, man.
Yeah, I know. There's more stuff.
Is that your stuff?
Then you know what to do.
That's a lot of stuff.
I have hurt myself.
Might be too much.
Seriously.